the merchandise hits the border, let's say this is the United States of America, USA, you have to do all kinds of stuff, right? You have to do all kinds of stuff to be prepared. You can't, the stuff just don't just end up here without any preliminary work, at least not most of the time. So to put the structure, you have to have knowledge of the work that has to be done beforehand. And part of that knowledge includes one thing which we'll study, is knowing the terminology, at least the basic terminology, so we can have a platform from which we can jump in and start discussing what happens here at the border between customs brokers, customs importers, and or their representatives, such as freight forwarders, etc. I was going to write something here. I forgot. All right. So things happen, right? So one of those things which I ask you to watch, if anyone watched the video, did anyone wonder, like, what does this have to do with customs brokerage? Like, it's kind of weird. This is because really what you were asked to observe is a question of contract. Contract, that's correct. It's really the agreement between two or more parties which really agree. Here's what I'm going to do, and here's what I'm going to do. And whenever you go, if you like me, use the subway, and sometimes you see those advertisements, like there is this company called Metro PCS, and they say, no contract required, come up to us. They are not telling you the truth, because there is a contract, it is just not annual contract and but monthly contract. And I think their legal department also told them this is not true advertising, because I think for the past month I started to see this adjective annual contract, right? It's not a student, otherwise I would pick up. Why I say student? Because those of you who know, we lock down the elevators, so if you need to come up, you would be calling me and I would be talking to you. But let's go back. Why am I asking you to talk about contract? Well, because depending on what you write down in a contract, it will define your rights and obligations. In a contract, you may write who is responsible for customs clearance. In a contract, you can also write who is responsible for insurance. In a contract, you can write who is responsible for delivery charges. And what section of delivery, international freight or the foreign inland freight, once it clears customs, who is responsible for getting this to end final point of destination, such as, let's say, Texas, assuming this is a West Coast. So a lot of those things, they really have to be worked before anything really takes place. And in the world of customs, so much influence has been done by this body called International Chamber of Commerce. It's a French Paris-based organization, I believe created after World War II, maybe earlier. And they're very influential. They do a bunch of things. They do international arbitration. But what concerns us for customs broker purposes is they influence customs so much, especially customs regulations, that customs as an agency, as the United States government, decided to adopt and incorporate their terminology into the regulatory language. And even if it hadn't adopted it, customs examiners assume that you know this stuff. And because they assume that you know this, they throw something on the exam question, something like CIF. And you're expected to know what it is. And nowhere in the Code of Federal Regulations they go through the trouble defining and clarifying what CIF actually stands for. So, but you kind of have to know this. So I said, you know what? There will be separate topic about this, and separate topic there was. And contract, assuming that you written and incorporated the terms, okay, yes? You're going to lock us out?
Yeah.
All right.
All right.
Thank you. Keep us safe. So, assuming that the language has been adopted and adopted properly, you put down who's responsible for what. So, if the ship goes into the storm and all on your container full of your merchandise ends up in the ocean, who, what happens then? Well, let's say your container leaks and your merchandise comes in damaged. What happens? This is you do beforehand. And this is why I ask you to watch the Incoterms. So if you haven't seen the whole thing, please see it, because it's really one of those fundamentals. Before we can jumpstart and talk about what really happens at the border, what documentation you submit, etc., you really have to know what are the rights and responsibilities are. Next, this is not enough. You also have to do a bunch of other things. One of the things, how about something which is kind of obvious, but may not be. Do you have a right to even file a paperwork with customs? And what gives you the right? That means that you have to know your role in the customs business. And as a licensed customs broker, you will have to know the role of the people who come to you for help. Because you before you start helping them, you have to know even that you have a right to help them. So last week, a client called me. A company headquartered in Israel. Their U.S. subsidiary company had problems at the border. What was the problem? Well, first of all, I asked them, okay, no problem. We'll work with your company. But the situation is this. You guys are over there in Israel. But the official importer is here in the United States. You call me from Israel, not these guys from the United States call me. So give me the documents that I can represent them. So what they do is they send me we should talk about it later, power of attorney from the company Israel, not in the United States. So what can I do? Can I call customs and say, I represent this company, meaning this company? No. See, and this is kind of intricacies that you really have to know before you start even doing things. Because if you don't do this right, you get yourself in trouble and you get others in trouble. So besides the contract, you have to know if you have a right to make an entry. Well, the party you represent has a right. What else? What about security issues? Since August, and because it came around August, just this August, it may be very very big for the next exam. Anyone heard of something called importer security filing? Right? And those elements you have to file before things even depart and go to the United States. And if you haven't done so, how much money are you liable for? Well, since August, it is $5,000 per each failure. I mean, of course, there are many ups and downs. There is downward criteria, upward criteria, but you have to do this. So security is another thing. So this is the reason why before we even start diving into this stuff, we're going to try to set up the foundation. And the good starting point begins with the part of the Code of Federal Regulation, in my opinion, general provisions. Well, why? Because they really, they are not, by themselves, they are not very huge. So you rarely see maybe one or two questions. Every other exam, you see general provisions on themselves being tested. But what you do see is you see you see on every, almost on every exam, concepts from the general provisions incorporated into the other questions which were being tested. So since a lot of customs exam customs broker exam questions are based on a process of elimination, to know what's right, you really also kind of required to know what is not right. And to do that, you kind of have to be aware of the whole universe. And in my opinion, to learn about this universe, general provisions is a good starting point. So let's discuss some of the concepts. Some of them are straightforward, so I'll be going through them real quick. Some of them are kind of tricky. That's where I'll be stopping. But I am not sure what you are not sure. So if there is something that I didn't cover very well, please raise your hand, just interrupt, and we'll have a discussion. So one of the things which would be nice to know is, when does customs have day off? We learned just this month, this last month, right, that sometimes they have a day off because there is no money in the budget to keep our federal agencies employed. They've been what's called furloughed. In regulations, there is no provision for furloughing because this is something like extraordinary event. Short of that, you have clearly a defined set of holidays and clearly defined set of other days that say when and when you're not working. Now, of course, when you read this outline, also take note, when I put everything in caps, it encompasses the main idea. Usually it is the name of that section. Underneath, as we shall see in a bit, I have something called small caps. This is like a sub-idea or the subdivision or the sub-paragraph within that section. But if in case you lose track, whenever you see small caps, it is usually an idea or a thought or discussion about this bigger idea, which is in big caps. So this is the structure, and you'll see this all throughout the outlines that we'll be covering throughout the semester. So business days. So obviously Monday to Friday, Saturday, Sunday are off, and national holidays are off. All right. So that's nice. What's national holidays? Well, national holidays is a set of holidays. Here is 10 of them. So you have New Year's Day, Labor Day, Thanksgiving, Christmas, Memorial, Independence. So you have a laundry list, right? Anyone? But is that it? What's a national day? Any other holiday, national holiday, that's not there? And does it matter? Does it really matter? I don't think it does. It may be helpful. But I think what helps is just to step aside at the structure and take a look at what the top says. So in the world of customs exam, you are limited most of the time to the, yes, you're bound to the, by the regulations, you're bound by the laws, just like customs is, and you're being tested on those. But you are tested on those regulations within a fact pattern. So usually customs will provide you a short paragraph saying this is what happened. And based on the situation, please apply the law to the facts, apply the regulations to the set of criteria that I've just given, and tell me the right outcome. And they give you 5 answer choices, which you will have to do. So, what does it mean? That means really that customs are free to choose the fact pattern. They try to stick to the real world, but sometimes they may not. Sometimes they may just go wander around in wishful thinking, something that rarely happens, and they are correct to do that. So why is that important? Because when customs examiner says in the fact pattern, President of the United States, I believe it's still Barack Obama, issued an executive order. Executive order are usually issued by the executive that Winnie Pooh Day is a national holiday. Winnie the Pooh is the bear, right? Now, isn't that, you will say that's odd, right? But it may be written by the customs examiner who has a child, and that child just is crazy about Winnie Pooh. So when she was writing the exam question, she was thinking about Winnie the Pooh. So, but the facts tell you that Winnie the Pooh, Barack Obama said, Winnie the Pooh Day, whatever it is, let's say January 15th, is a national holiday. And then they ask you based on that the relevant question. Are you allowed to say, no, Winnie the Pooh is not national? I know it's not. I know it's not. It's not here, and it's not in the Federal Register. It's not. Well, for customs exam purposes, you have to take it as true because this is the facts they said. Customs examiners are free to provide you with the facts. They are not free to stray away from the law. And whenever they stray away, you usually see those questions being revoked and students getting extra points, which is nice. But the point of that is that if it's done by the federal statute, which means the Congress, or by the president, Barack Obama, then anything that's not listed here is also a fair game. So, one such holiday is Mother's Day, right? But comes the important punchline. If a holiday falls on Saturday, the day immediately preceding such Saturday will be observed. If a holiday falls on Sunday, the day immediately following such Sunday will be observed. How nice. When is the Mother's Day on? I believe it's on Sundays, if I'm not mistaken. Mother's Day became, for those who, you all have access to Google. So if in case I say something which is totally awkward or just totally outrageous, or maybe you're just curious, you're welcome to Google it. So if the Mother's Day falls on Saturday and you Google and Google says it falls on Saturday, not on Sunday, but I say it's on Sunday, please let me know. Because Google knows a lot more information, has a lot of more information, but I have the logic. So that's why I'm standing in front of you, not the Google is in front of you. Although it may be both, right? Next. So what does it mean? So Mother's Day falls on Sunday. So that means customs will have the day off on Monday, right? So are you going to show up at the customs house and say, customs, I need to clear the entry right the day after the Mother's Day? No. What it also means is, perhaps more importantly, is that as we dive further into this structure of the customs world, we also learn that there are certain deadlines.